Hey guys, so thanks to Wizkids, we have a slightly more diverse pool of our Shredder's Return stuff, our TMNT Series 3. So we're going to take the chance to go figure by figure and talk about what's going to be in competitive play, what's pretty much going to be strictly relegated to the kitchen table, and what's going to be in between. There are some ideas in these figures. Also note that a lot of the conversation is had with regards to Flash being the oldest set in the current modern era when I'm talking about this. Next modern shift could change, so keep an eye on these figures. That's why we don't completely discount them when we do these figure reviews. So in the meantime, enjoy this figure review, and see you guys on the flip side. It's time to go over the set, what we have. We're just going to use the cards for this time around. I don't want to fiddle around with the models, and help speed up the process because I do need to start talking a little bit more about the kitchen table game. It's a neglected part of our channel, and we're going to get a little bit more casual in some of our topics and some of our shows. So look forward to that for those more kitchen table-based casual players. But in the meantime, here's Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles 3. Away we go. So we start off with Raphael. Raphael is got the TMNT ally, animal, and martial artist keywords. And him and his brothers all have this ninja power, bro, trait. It is a unique modifier, and there'll always be another character. In this case, Raphael, when he's adjacent to Michelangelo, can modify his defense value by +1 against range attacks. A little like ESD light, as it were. And he can use a carry ability to carry up to 3 characters with TMNT keyword. We look at his stats. He's got a 5-click dial with Indomitable, Blades Claws off the top for the first 3 clicks, and then he moves to Precision Strike later on. Raphael's cool. Though he won't be making splash in the competitive circuit, at the kitchen table he will be a good addition to your TMNT allies or TMNT teams or animal teams. But that carry ability that all these guys have is going to make these 88 Mirage series turtles very interesting. Though Raphael, about halfway the game, isn't going to be able to be carried. So, though not competitive, he's got some fun possibilities, to say the least. So that's Raphael. Moving on to one of his brothers, Monsieur Michelangelo. Also TMNT ally, I'm animal martial artist. So I'm going to, with the brothers, I'm going to just let you know if there's anything different from the other ones for keywords from here. But his ninja power bro is triggered by Donatello, where he gets +1 from range attacks. And of course, if he can use carry if he's adjacent to Donatello. His stats, once again, colors on the dial. Now, he's a little bit more of a close combat-focused character. And again, like his brother, not super competitive, but a kitchen table game. You know, if you're using the 4 Ninja Turtles together on a TMNT team, he's a really good get-in-the-face close combatant that turns into a perplexer later on. Very, very backup fighter-type character. He's probably going to be one of your guys leading in the carry. That sidestep can go a long way when combined with the ability to carry 3 characters with the TMNT keyword. So look to that. Also, don't neglect that TMNT keyword on its own. You're not just limited to these particular characters. It could be another character named Donatello that might be good. So, chase. So, yeah. Alright, next up we have Donatello. His ninja power bro is triggered by Leonardo. He's got special movement power. Donatello can use Force Blast and Plasticity. Good combination of powers. Weird combination of powers, because Plasticity keeps you along. Force Blast lets you move them away. Now, the Force Blast, of course, can be to help you pick and choose your targets. His dial ends with some flurry. It has Quake all the way through, so he's got some bouncing around coming out of this Donatello. A little bit of mid-dial willpower, energy shield at the top, outwit. He's a good backup player for your team. Also, never forget that Force Blast allows you to make knockbacks, or allows you to force your opponent to take knockback, after an attack on a regular basis. So Donatello could go a long way, and outwit on a later dial, push him ahead to carry maybe 2 turns in a row to get some movement out of your turtles, and Donatello might help you out. So, again, the 4 turtles, not super competitive, though I think there was some potential in one of them, maybe Raphael. But, you know, as part of a TMNT team that synergizes with his brothers, could go a long way. Anyway, next up, Leonardo. He's triggered by Raphael, And really, really good stats on a 50-point character. Lacks the indomitable that Raphael has, but makes up for it with a slightly higher defense and some leadership. The leadership, in this case, is not going to work on his brothers who are the same point value. Never forget that you do get the extra action in the first place, and these guys are all low points. So four 50-point characters, let's say we're playing even a 300-point game, you're now at four possible actions that you can take, plus you still need 100 points. So that leadership can go a long way in a 1-3 shot. And as well, whatever else you add to the team could also be smaller points, so Leo could work for you in that sense. All right. Anyway, next up, April O'Neil. She's a TMNT ally and a reporter, and she's got a freelance reporter special attack power. At the beginning of your turn, you may choose an opposing character within four squares and line of fire. Until your next turn, that character can't be targeted with perplex or probability control from a character friendly to it. Not too shabby. The reporters are definitely a wacky thing. I want to try a full team of reporters one day and see how all the reporter abilities kind of pull off. The more and more they add, the more and more I want to try to make something happen with, you know, there's a lot of supermen who have the reporter keyword that could be part of a bigger team. Definitely a fun addition. And she can squeeze into a lot of teams at 40 points for the TMNT ally keyword to use that perplex or probability control knocker on. So, you know, a really strong support for your tabletop team or your kitchen table team. And, you know, that's a great place for her. All right, next up, Fugitoid, TMNT ally, robot, and scientist keywords. He's got Crisis Time Machine. Fugitoid can use probability control once per turn. When a character within range and line of fire rolls a critical hit or critical miss, the attack may be rerolled. So it's like an additional prob for extreme cases in that sense. And it's not specifically called prob because probability control itself is limited to a single use on your team. He's going to be relegated to a kitchen table team. But you know what's great on kitchen table teams is more often than not, you're playing at a theme team, which gives you a bunch of probability controls. And Fugitoid just adds to the probability control and lets you keep your count high. And he is indomitable and he's a bit of a target. And he's got TK to create some positioning. So could be a really good ally to some TMNTs. Or, you know, if you've got a place for him in a robot or scientist team, look to that. Not super competitive in that sense. All right, next up, the Foot Tech Qatar. He's got Foot Clan, TMNT, Villain, and Science. You know what? All four of them have the same keywords, all right? And they all are capable of shooting out of base. They are all different ranges, ranging from 2, 5, 3, and 2. We'll go through them very quickly. First, we'll start with the trait, which they all have, and then I'll individually go through their weapons. The Foot Tech, Invisibility Tech, rather, sorry. Give Foot Tech a power action to place an invisible token on this card, if there isn't one already on it. While there is an invisible token on this card, Foot Tech can't be targeted by non-adjacent opposing characters and modifies its defense value by +2. When Foot Tech attacks or is attacked, after actions resolve, remove the invisible token. So that's, again, on all four of them. Gives them a beefier defense to start off if you're smart about using that. And then the Qatar one has Qatar Penetrating Dagger. Foot Tech can use Blaze Claws, and when it makes a close attack occupying hand and terrain, the damage dealt is penetrating. All of these pretty much have the same place in the same fun team, which is generally all on the same team. They're Foot Clan, they're cheap at 35 points. Not particularly thick and dial, but very difficult to kill for the points that you're paying for them. So yeah, so they're all going to be okay on those teams. And I think one or two of them has a place that could be squeezed in a competitive play in a very specific situation that somebody's willing to pull off. Anyway, the Foot Tech with the 3-segment staff. Give them a power action, make a close attack, targeting up to 3 adjacent opposing characters. Hit characters are each dealt 1 damage instead of normal damage and given an action token. That's one of the ones I think has some specific team that's going to use it and is going to catch people off guard if it does functional anyway. Oh, but he starts with energy explosion. Maybe not. Interesting, because he does have to take a damage, and a lot of times when these guys are taking damage, you're not. So, again, still part of the same Foot Clan, Foot Tech teams, or Super TMNT villain teams for your table games. The Shuriken Weapon of Distraction, unique modifier, when Foot Tech hits with a range attack, hit characters, modify their attack. Oh my gosh, I stopped learning how to read. And defense values by -1 until your next turn. Now that's a really good stat drop, and he does start with that with a 5 range and running shot of 9. So effectively a 10 square reach. It could be very obnoxious if used in the right situations. So look to that as a interesting stat dropper. Catch your opponents off guard. Maybe in competitive play, but especially fun in your tabletop kitchen table games. All right, next up, the Foot Tech with Twin Katanas. He can use Blaze Claws and Fangs, and when he does, he rolls 2d6, and you get to choose one of the results, which is neat, rolling 2 dice and picking the high one. I mean, me rolling 2 ones, I'm not going to get a lot of love out of him, but for 35, again, 35 points, charge, not too terrible, but a good addition to your TMNT villains. All right, we move into the uncommon slot. Starting off with Casey Jones. He's got the TMNT ally keyword and the Goongala attack power. Casey Jones can use, Goongala is how this one would sound because he's from the IDW, or not the Nickelodeon animated series from 2012. Casey Jones can use Quake after action results in which he moved 3 squares or less. He can use Quake as a free action. That's his attack power, which he has in his last 3 clicks. He does start with Running Shot, Energy Explosion. This is a 4 range, but the fact that he can move 5, just a 9 square reach. He does have Empower as well to, you know, help along. I mean, you're going to get in there within 4 squares. Why not get him up to 2 squares or 1 or, yeah, 2 squares away and then have somebody move up beside him? Very, for the tactical kitchen table player, he's going to be pretty cool. Not going to be making too much of a splash in the meta play, but, you know, very cool figure. I like him. Deal with it. Splinter, TMNT ally, animal, and martial artist. April, let me teach you. Splinter can use Empower. He's also got a unique modifier. When Splinter hits an opposing character, modify the attack value of all four other friendly characters by +1 this turn. It's a really cool effect that if you can get it off with his 11 attack, isn't too bad. He does have sidestep to get him in a little bit further. He is only 25 points. Not a terrible investment if you can pull it off. But that is the trick, is if you can pull it off. That said, he's a really good addition to your TMNT ally teams or your funny animal teams just to make it all worth it. Heck, you could even squeeze him into a martial artist team because martial artists always have really high attacks as well. All right, next up we got the Purple Dragon with the Purple Dragon keyword. Not much to be said about this guy. If you're making a Purple Dragon team, which only really just started showing up, go for it. This is going to be one of those guys that's going to be really kind of fun to see a ton of Purple Dragons across the table if somebody's willing to do that. Otherwise, not seeing competitive play. Mohawk Punk, on the other hand, has also got the same kind of story. He's also a Purple Dragon, and is what you see, what you get dial with 3 clicks. He's 15 points, but he does have Blaze Claws, Fangs, Plasticity, and some late dial Battle Fury. Now, the Battle Fury can get around some shape change if you happen to hold the right character with the Plasticity. That second click is really kind of iffy. Ultimately, if this guy gets hit, he's basically done. But if he does hit, he hits hard. So 15 points, not the worst 15 points you could spend. But, you know, very fun figure, especially if you're playing one of those 80 animated series styles. Gangs of punks that the ninja shows you to beat up on. Alright, next up, Krang, based on the animated series. So this is a generic Krang. The Krangs that will Krang the Krang. I want to read off all these powers because this is hilarious. He's got the Utrum keyword. He's special movement power, scurrying tendrils. Krang can use Flurry and Sidestep. And then he's got Mind Control in the name of the will that you will be obeying is the will of the Krang. Then this Precision Strike Krang has performed that which is known as Locking On. Then his Super Senses. No one's attack holds no surprise for Krang. This one's attack holds no surprise for the Krang. I messed that one up. Combat Reflexes. Krang would prefer that you stopped hitting Krang. Is that way? Krang shall know the weakness for you with Krang's device. I'm laughing at myself. I'm going to stop now. I apologize for that little outburst there. 4 clicks. He's got some mind control. He's tiny. Not hard to move around, but his defense values are really a weak point. But I would love to see a bunch of brains across the table. And, you know, enough of these guys in a higher point game, or even, you know, this Utram keyword, which is really starting to look really strong with Krangs and the Krangs that Krang the Krangs, is looking really good and interesting. All right, next up, Bebop. Prior to transformation, volunteer to become stronger. Him and Rocksteady have this when Bebop KOs an opposing character. KOs an opposing character or rolls a critical hit or is healed after action resolve. Place a mutagen token on this card. Oh my goodness, I'm terrible today. And you may roll a d6 that can't be rerolled. If the result plus the number of mutagen tokens is 7 or more, replace this character with a character with the same click number named Bebop with a point value of 100 points or less, then heal that character one click. He ignores hindering for movement. He's a Foot Clan and Purple Dragon. It's from the 88 comic series. Eh, not bad. He can kind of muscle it out in some close combat, which goes a long way. 50 points, not making the competitive scene, but this is probably the Bebop you want to start with if you're looking to keep a couple Bebop options in the sideline. Ooh, he's like his own little Bebop ID card. But he's got to be doing well to work, so. next up, Rocksteady. Same kind of idea with the mutagen power. He ignores hindering for line of fire, and he's a little bit more shooty with some running shot. 4 range, 50 points. Used in conjunction with Bebop. Look for a lot of fun with these two together. More beef for your Purple Dragon teams. And great kitchen table fun for sure. Next up, Rocksteady. TMNT villain, animal, and brute keywords. Then he's got the banished trait, which is also on the Bebop, which I believe we have. Yep. Stop for the rest of the game. Rocksteady can't be healed. It's a thus late dial, which gives him support later on. Not super, super great for competitive play. Could be an interesting call-in for this guy, or change-up for this guy, rather. And that, you know, that dial makes him more work than is necessary, to be brutally honest. So, yeah, not to be pooped on, but he's probably, he's not the best Rocksteady to choose from, but if you want to make it in a multiple universe of Rocksteadies and Bebops, go for it. There's nothing wrong with using him at all. Alright, next up, Mallow. Purple Dragon TMNT ally keywords. He's got the swinging crowbar attack power. When an opposing character takes damage from Mallow's attack, after actions resolve, give that character an action token. That's always obnoxious to get hit and have to take an action token if you're getting charged with a 45 point character who can deal 3 damage. Not bad for a dude with a crowbar, but not super fantastic for competitive play. The kitchen table, though, I want to see him leading a bunch of hymns. Because that's just the image I get from the... This is from the 2011 comic series. And I honestly, I've still to this day think I'm really messing up the pronunciation of his name. But, you know, he's keeping the Purple Dragons going. Probably could have got done with some leadership because I believe he's one of the leaders of the Purple Dragon. But other than that, that's, you know, going to be a fun character for a Purple Dragon team. All right, next up, Mona Lisa from the animated series, well, Turtles in Space series seasons. And she's got a trait, I would recognize that rage anywhere. I'm sorry for that glaring on the cards, guys. It's just we kind of need the light above us. Anyway, a named theme team may include Mona Lisa and is still a theme team if your force includes a character named Raphael and is a unique modifier when adjacent to or attacking a character named Raphael. Modify Mona Lisa's attack value by +1. She's also got a special attack power. Mona Lisa can use Blaze Claws, Fangs, Flurry, Giant Reach 2. She ignores elevated and hindering terrain for movement. 100 points. It starts with a range dial, moves to a close combat dial, 6 range, 2 targets. So 2 targets with energy explosion, not terrible. Range combat expert to do some more concentrated damage. So spread it out, concentrate it, however you feel like it. Go through some defenses. Throw her on a team with a Raphael, make her a little bit better. There's a couple good Raphaels that are Raphaels that are really good for low points. I can't pronounce anything today. That are good at lower point values, kind of beef her up. Or you can use the Turtles in Space one, which we unfortunately didn't get, so we don't have it for this episode. But Mona Lisa is a very interesting character and a good choice of keywords, to say the least. Animal, Cosmic, and Soldier are all really good. Again, kitchen table choice for sure. Competitive play? Probably not. Either way. All right, next up, Bebop. He's got the Banished power, a little bit more close combat focused than the Rocksteady. Not much to be said except for the fact that everything I said about the Rocksteady applies to this character. And that's, you know, go across the universe of Bebops or call him, or, you know, mutagen the other Bebop into him. Either way, don't expect much outside of that, but you know, a lot of people have been pooping on him. I think there's something there. I just got to figure it out. All right, next up. He's a Shredder clone. He's got the trait, Ocean Resurrection. When Shredder clone would be KO'd, you may replace him with figure number 35, Shark Shredder, on click 4. That character can't be healed this game except by using Steel Energy. Pretty cool. Cool keep you alive power. It does require that you attain a chase, but that also means you're paying 10 extra points for this character. So that's the trade-off. 10 extra points makes him live longer. Not bad, and let's see what goes on from there. Duel of Twisted Honor at the beginning of the game. Choose an opposing character that isn't the lowest point character on on that force. Opposing characters that weren't chosen modify attack values by -2 when attacking Shredder clone, unless the chosen character has been KO'd. Shredder clone can use sidestep when he moves after action resolve. Deal 1 penetrating damage to each adjacent opposing character that he wasn't adjacent to the beginning of the move. So you can, and he does have sidestep, so you can sidestep in, deal the 1 damage, and then if you so choose, attempt to break away from that guy and try to deal damage to other characters because you started that move adjacent. That one, really cool. I love dealing damage without having to roll dice, to say the least. It's one of my favorite things to have to be able to do. He also comes with leadership, 18 defense, indomitable, very, very solid dial, very good attack value. Look at that. And then he does get into some Battle Fury late dial to get through that, deal with some super senses, flurry all throughout the middle of it. Not too shabby, especially when he comes with the ability to lead in, dealing, you know, damage to his opponent with some sidestep without having to roll the dice. And then when you do roll the dice, it's with really reasonably good numbers. And he's indomitable. This guy is going to see competitive play. So careful when using him on the kitchen table. Maybe keep the Shark Shredder at home when you do so, so as not to unmake friends, to say the least. All right. Next up. Leonardo, TMNT, did I get the Foot Clan TMNT villain, mystical ruler, warrior keywords on that one? I apologize if I'm missing keywords, guys. It's just a thing. I get into a smooth move. This is why I show you the card, though, so that when I screw up, you guys have the information there to work with. All right, Leonardo is a super rare. That's the slot we're in now. He's TMNT ally, animal, cosmic, and martial artist. Him and the other space turtles, which we didn't get, have the zero-g ninjutsu trait. Leonardo can use the flight ability. Note that it's a flight ability that does not include carry. That would require either the flight symbol or actually being given the ability carry. And ignores knockback damage. When given a non-free action, if Leonardo is adjacent to blocking terrain or higher or a square of higher elevation, Leonardo modifies his speed and attack values by +1 for that action. So when he's given a non-free action, if he's adjacent to modifies his speed. That's pretty cool. So, unfortunately, it doesn't work in conjunction with some powers, but it's a really cool thing if you can get into a good position with it. Anyway, then he's got this Racing for the Pieces of the Black Hole Generator. When an opposing character would be equipped or begins the game equipped, you and that character's controller each roll 2d6. It can't be rerolled. If your result is higher, remove that equipment from the game. Now, this is an interesting power that will work both in competitive and in friendly play. A lot of time friendly play, I've seen my buddies put pieces of the Hulkbuster things just to fill up points on their team. And you'll note that this triggers at the beginning of the game or when a character would be equipped. So if a character is about to become equipped, what you do is you roll these 2d6 off each, and then if you win the dice roll, being the guy controlling Leonardo, you remove that equipment from the game. Not too shabby. And it also comes with a very reasonable dial at 7 range. And really, really good stats. Attack that doesn't drop below 10. Pretty solid damage output. Very good range, especially when you consider the fact that running shot comes with flight. There's going to be some potential in this character. Some people are going to use him. And he will see play in both styles of play. And he's definitely going to be a big target in the kitchen table game. He probably won't do as much with this trait, but between this... and everything that we see here on this dial, there's a lot going on that this Leonardo is going to bring Next up, Savante Romero. TMNT villain, monster, mystical past, and ruler keywords. Carry me to safety, Dino. Give Savante Romero a power action and place adjacent a pterodactyl bystander. If none are on the map, this is a free action instead. Note that this is what a pterodactyl looks like. 10 movement, 9 attack with blades, 16 defense with energy shield. 1 damage. He's also got the blackest of magics. Savante Romero can use probability control. When an opposing character is KO'd, place a black magic token on his card. Once during your opponent's turn, you may remove a black magic token from his card to use probability control a second time. Now, he also kind of gets all of his special powers after his first click, where he starts with some phasing. He has an 8 range, 2 targets, comes in at 100 points. This is going to be that guy that you're willing to push off the top. Not making a splash in the meta play because I feel like this first click really hampers him big time. Tabletop games, though, I can't wait to get some pterodactyls out and carry him around and scream pterodactyl noises at people, but they won't be making noises with peas because peas are silent in pterodactyl. I'm so sorry, guys. I'm a father. I had to do that. All right, last but not least, our Chase, the mini shredder. Now, we've actually managed to pull two of them. If you guys watched our live unboxing, we got a mini shredder as well. He's a little guy. He's got the Foot Clan, TMNT villain, monster, and warrior keywords. He's got a mystical worms trait, which all the other Chases also have. When mini shredder would be KO'd for the first time each game, instead turn with click number 4 and an opponent places him adjacent to one of their characters, this can't be ignored. His second is the Shredder Elite trade, which gives him sidestep and the ability to do 1 penetrating damage to a character that he moved adjacent to that he didn't start adjacent to. He also comes with plasticity and stealth. Honestly, this guy is going to surprise people. He's indomitable to add to it. Very high attack with some precision strike. And that plasticity makes it very easy for him to break away from people. So, you know, when you're rolling anything but a 1 to break away to deal the penetrating damage off of people, that I think goes a very long way towards making this guy, and especially the fact that he's tiny, means he can be carried by just about anybody bigger than a tiny, which is a lot of characters. So definitely going to see competitive play. I would not be surprised if he already has seen competitive play. I know I have some thoughts for him. And table game, I mean, I think this character falls under the Devil Dinosaur realm of, oh my gosh, he's so fun, he's so cute and cool looking, and he's really good. So that's the mini shredder. So this is TMNT Series 3, guys. Not a terrible set, but not a very competitive set. The competitive figures are a little bit more top-heavy, and a lot of them are just the figures named Shredder, along with the Leo. Though we don't actually have our hands on the Space Turtles, I do remember some of them being pretty interesting, though not necessarily on the competitive level that Leo is. The Shredder clone and the Mini Shredder will see some action, I'm sure of it. It's just a matter of how. So hope you guys enjoyed this video. Once again, thank you very much, Wizkids, for sending us that second Bach gravity feed of Shredder Returns, and we hope to see you guys for another fun unboxing series.